Wednesday, June 29th, 2022. If you please rise for the pledge, it's over there on First Citizens National Bank.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
It's on the chief's shoulder, Chris.
Yeah, you got it. Thank you. Dennis, will you open us in prayer?
Yes, sir. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for this weather that we're enjoying. We ask you to be with us today as we make decisions for this city. We ask you to lead, guide, and direct us. These things we ask in thy name. Amen.
Thank you. Roll call, please show all present with Ms. Mary Claire Hopper and Willie Coe. I think they're both out of town. We do have enough folks here with the quorum and can conduct business, so. Next item on the agenda will be approval of minutes from June 21st, 2022. I'd entertain a motion to approve those.
I so move.
Motion from James Baltimore. Is there a second?
Second.
Second from Dennis Moody. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, motion carries. Unfinished business. Is there any unfinished business? None? Okay. New business. Under new business, public hearing. Ordinance DB-707, mobile food vendors. At our last board meeting, we gave notice of this hearing today for mobile food vendors. And at this time, that was included in your packet. Any questions about this ordinance?
Just to confirm, it will replace the previous.
Yes.
Yes.
I think if you...
on the cover.
Right. Whereas the Board of Mayor and Alderman deems it necessary to replace said ordinance to be legal and enforceable under the laws of the state of Tennessee, and whereas the Board of Mayor and Alderman has given public due public notice on said repeal and replacement and has held public hearing, which is what we're doing today. That's going to replace ordinance BB-672. That's listed in the first paragraph. Any questions? Anything? All right, entertain a motion to approve this ordinance for mobile food trucks.
So moved.
A motion from Donna Webb. Is there a second?
Second.
Second from Ricky Hammond. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, motion carries. The next item on the agenda is ordinance DB-708, public hearing for refuse and trash disposal ordinance. This is something we've talked about for many months. The ordinance was completed maybe one day last week. We got it from Christine. Y'all got a draft copy yesterday, and then I emailed it to you last night and gave you the printed version today. So Greg Wilson is here. If you have any questions about the process or the cans being delivered, we talked a little bit about that, but I'd entertain a motion to approve it so we can discuss it. A motion from James Baltimore. Is there a second?
Second.
Second from Megan. Or any discussion or questions?
When are we going to begin?
Ask Greg.
Cans will be, we'll begin delivering those cans on July the 11th. Okay. They tell me it'll take about 5 days to get everything, to get them all distributed. Okay. I'm giving a little leeway on that, giving a few extra days. I'm thinking by the 25th, we will be headed out with our sidearm trucks and start picking up trash at the curb. I would like to say this, though. Once you get a can delivered to your house, you are expected to bring that can to the road on your pickup day. When we deliver those cans, there will be a door hanger hanging on that can with your pickup day. We ask that the cans be out there by 6 o'clock in the morning and removed and put back either next to the house or behind the house by 7 o'clock that evening.
Will it be a house number on that can, or will it be?
There will be a serial number on there, and it will be assigned to a specific address.
If a resident wants a second can, when can they request that?
I would say give us a couple weeks to get things lined out with one can first. No sooner than August, I would think. Let's get the one can out first, and if you're going to need a second one, we'll work with you for a couple of weeks checks if you got more than one can of hold. If it looks like you're going to continue to have more than one can of hold, give us a couple weeks at least before we start requesting our additional can.
What will be the cost of that second can to the customer, and how much will it cost to have it empty once a week? How much extra over the $22 a month will that be if we decided that?
$5. So the
$5 to empty, okay.
Yes, sir, the second can. And the can, the second can, the first one's free. The city is paying for all the cans. Probably, how much was that, Greg?
$397,000.
Yeah, just shy of $400,000.
Yeah, we just approved that the other day. So $400,000, the city's buying the first 96-gallon container. If a second one is needed, the customer can request one. It's $75 for that. That's about the average cost of that can. And if there's an additional pickup with two cans, that one extra can is $5, and that's in the schedule fees, actually in the budget per month.
Right. And if a can is lost or damaged or stolen or something, it'll be $75
for replacement. Yes, sir. If it's our fault, if it's our guys, we will do that.
If it's not the city's fault, it'll be $75.
Right. Yes, sir.
That is subject to change if the costs go up on the cans.
All the cans gonna be the same color?
Yes.
Yeah, they're awesome.
I know in some towns, they have orange and they have the gray ones.
Ours will be, I don't think you'll mistake ours for anybody else's. They're gonna be black with the yellow city on both sides.
On both sides. I'll send y'all an image of that. Got an image of it. And all this is contained in an ordinance. All of this about having it at the curb, I say. And we realize it's a big change for our community, but we are probably the last town in West Tennessee that's provided vacuum pickup. And obviously, we've talked about this for a number of years, and doing this for lots of reasons. Number one, to make things cleaner in our community. Number two, to reduce our worker comp claims that Sue Teague would be proud of. Number three, avoid dog bites and issues with going in backyards and fences. Number four, to save money in order to anticipate future expansion of the landfill. So lots of reasons we're doing this. We think it'll be successful. And again, it's a huge change. And we'll get the information out there. We talk about the hardship applications for folks that don't have the ability to get the cans out there. I've talked to three or four people about that. I've got a list that I will get that to them. But we will publicize that. We'll get that information out. If you read that ordinance, those applications will be online at our city website. They'll also be online on our Facebook page, and obviously we'll have them here at City Hall. The ladies behind the counter will have those, and we'll let the EOC folks know as well about that. But it is a big change. They're going through the routes right now, so your day may or may not be the same. But that process is ongoing. It should be completed pretty soon about your data pickup. So looking forward to it. And again, it's a big change. We know it's a big change, but I think it's going to be beneficial for our community in the long run.
But your data pickup will be on the door hanger.
Yes, it will. Yes.
Yeah, when we deliver the cans, your data pickup will be, or your day of pickup will be on that door hanger.
And these roll off the roller containers will probably hold twice what a normal can would cost.
Right. Most people don't have a can near the size of a 96-gallon can. Some have three or four cans. But very seldom do you run across anybody in the city that has a 96-gallon can. That's a big can. If you have more trash than a 96-gallon can can hold, you know, we'll just have to, you'll have to request one property owner or be responsible for the one-time lease fee on that to deliver, and then we'll get you one out of there.
Your pickup day is a Monday, and Monday's a holiday. It'll be the next day, but will y'all do double routes or something? I mean, people that normally pick up on Tuesday, will they still be picked up on Tuesday, or will that push them?
It'll push, more than likely, it's going to push the whole route one day. We'll just have to see how it works out. We've got two major holidays where we have 2 weeks off, or 2 days off in a week's time. Now, those we'll have to push and get done in 3 days. You got Thanksgiving and Christmas. You know, we're off Thursday and Friday on Thanksgiving, and we get off 2 days, you know, for Christmas Eve and Christmas Day. It'll be basically kind of like what we're doing now. because when we do these sidearms and curbside service, we're actually gonna provide this service in 4 days instead of 5 now. So that kinda gives us a day we can shift. That 5th day is gonna be our cleanup and maintenance day. Because these trucks are gonna require a lot of maintenance, a lot of greasing to take care of and make sure everything keeps working properly. So that's gonna be a weekly thing. So maybe if I can work the routes out correctly, where we can have one day in the week where we have a little shorter route, then we'll be greasing twice a week on the side of.
Well, I guess the city's gonna own the trucks then, right?
Well, they're on the buyback program. We already have the trucks here and they are on the buyback program.
And we'll publicize those routes. We'll get all that information out. A lot of information we're gonna hand out and get out to the public, the routes, the hardship applications, the data you're picked up. So we're gonna work really hard to get that information out.
I hope to have those routes done by Monday or Tuesday next week.
Okay.
Once you've been to pick up, how many days do you have to get that can off the front of the alley?
7 o'clock.
That day.
Greg, I know we talked one day about the obstructions with the vehicles and stuff, you and the chief, and I know our attorney's probably involved in that too, right? As far as, I know it mentioned something in here, but did y'all go in depth on that?
I think the ordinance says we can't get to it. We'll get you next week.
We'll get you next week.
Okay, well, if it continues to be a problem, do we cite them?
Well, we'll visit with them and ask them to help us, collaborate with us.
I mean, sometimes you have a neighbor parks in front of your house and things like that. Especially ones with joint driveways, a few streets with joint driveways and all.
Right.
We gotta try to work with them some way or.
We will. We're gonna give a little leeway to start with and try to talk with folks. In the beginning, it's gonna take 2 or 3 months probably for everybody to get used to this and get used to when we're coming and know that, you know, you can't park on the street, that, you know, we got the trash today, so.
We had that same issue yesterday. We ain't got the cans out yet. We had a street that you couldn't get up and down. People were having to turn around and go in the way from the car.
Yeah, they do that now. Yeah.
Are you gonna have a second person in the cab with the driver?
Maybe to start off.
Start with, okay.
Maybe to start off. Eventually it'll be one man.
But the hardship will have a separate truck kind of going and pulling the cans down ahead of.
Yes, we will. And we'll probably have to do some reassessing on that. We'll decide, depending on how many there is. If we have several of those, we'll probably send somebody out with a pickup truck going around and pulling all those cans to the road. If they're available. If not, the driver will get out when he gets there. We'll can the road. And one good thing about that is these trucks are set up where he doesn't actually have to get back inside the truck to dump it. He can leave his door open, bring a can to the truck, and there's two levers just inside the door right next to the lever. He can dump it from the ground and take the can back to the house and then come back and get in the truck if he has to. So it makes it a little more user-friendly for the driver as well.
I can't get my pickup around Pecan Cove. How are you going to get that big truck?
You can't get your pickup around?
I mean, I know
I've been running a garbage truck around that cove for years.
I know we've looked at it. I hope we've looked there. I mean,
there are going to be places that we still have the rear loader with the can flippers. We still have the satellite trucks, and they're going to run some of the difficult places. We've got a lot of dead ends and out-of-the-way places, businesses and things like that, that our little satellite trucks are going to take care of.
I know we have a lot of ditches in town, and the street's not very wide. Are they going to be able to get in and get around?
I mean, it's no bigger than our route trucks that we're running now. I mean, it's the same size truck.
And a really
The dimensions of the truck is no bigger than the real cargo trucks that we're running right now.
Okay, I just assumed it's going to be a little bigger operation, but it won't be. It'll be just like what you've always.
The length of the truck is pretty much the same as what we're running right now.
Okay.
Now, where we may run into trouble is when they set the can out, or we don't have enough room to reach out. Where wherever they place their can, they're gonna have to make sure it's not next to a fence or next to a mailbox or anything that that thing can grab. It's gonna have to be at least 3 or 4 feet away from anything where the arm can grab it.
Is that on the door hanger? I mean, I know it says, you know, convenient location in the ordinance, but like, could we specify in that door hanger, like, make sure it's, you know, 3 to 5 feet away from any obstructions or?
I have to look and see what they've got prepared now.
Oh, it's already maybe printed?
They're working on it now. I do know that.
I think this was already said then, but once those are done, can we post like an example on the Facebook? I'm sure that was planned, but cool.
You don't want the cans, you do not want the cans in the street. You want them on the sidewalk or in the yard or whatever.
If at all possible, yes. You don't want to block the street.
Definitely.
Well, I meant right on the street.
Yeah, I mean, but the arms on these trucks will reach out 9.5 feet. So they, you know, if we've got a little leeway to reach out and grab them, if you need to set them, to keep them away from a mailbox, you know, if you need to set it on the other side and back off the road, just a few feet, 2 or 3 feet would be fine. Because we can reach out about 9.5 feet with that arm and then pull it in and dump it.
Let them accomplish the question.
Yeah, sure.
I believe our biggest issue is going to be parking. People parking in the streets is going to be our biggest problem.
All right, any more discussion? Okay, have a motion, a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, motion carries. Thank you all very much. I look forward to working with Greg and his crew and get the information out there to everybody. So we'll certainly do that. Next item on the agenda is the amend the 2021-2022 budget. Steve Anderson. Steve? Stop. And this is something we do every year, kind of a house cleaning measure, I guess. As well as we can, right, Steve?
Yeah, still, like Chloe said when she came to the board meeting, there's still a lot of things that happen in July and even August that affect the current year, so there's no way to do it and guarantee that you're not going to go over budget, but this is at least an attempt to do that. And a lot of these things, a lot of the general fund has to do with ARPA funds that we received that weren't budgeted, and then the money that was spent because of that. But then the other ones are just various things that come up throughout the year that go over budget. And we make these amendments in order to not spend more than we budget. But if anybody's got any questions specifically about any of them, I will answer those.
So everything that's on here is done within the budget, right?
Sir?
Everything on here is done within the budget, even though...
This is changing the budget, yeah. This is changing the original budget.
Again, this is just a kind of a house cleaning measure that we do prior to the end of our budget year. So when it comes time for the audit, we don't get a write-up for something not being correct. And I know Steve and the folks up here do a good job get all that done. But like Steve said, we still got stuff that's going to come in July and August, and we're doing the best we can to try to get this corrected as much as possible. Is that right, Steve?
That's right.
Okay. Do it every year. Do this every year. Any questions about this? Are you going to ask a question, Megan?
I mean, would you mind just going through it real quick, like a brief little overview of the changes? Is that too much to ask?
No, you want me to go through all of them?
Not all of them, but any. I mean, if you could just go over. Where you saw the biggest changes from our original budget?
The biggest changes are going to be with the ARPA funds.
Okay.
If you'll see on that first page, it was zero budgeted, and we changed the budget to $2.4 million.
Right.
Because that's money that we received that we weren't aware of.
So then that affects some of the expenditures down below that we had due to receiving that money.
Absolutely.
Then we had, if you see the airport sales.
Yeah.
The reason that's up is because of fuel prices. Fuel prices are up, so we're spending more to purchase fuel, but we're also bringing in more revenue selling the fuel.
I understand.
That police building's capital outlay, the reason that is being amended is because I didn't, when I budgeted all of that, that's part of the down, the Southtown grant, and I had that all budgeted under park areas because that's where most of that money's being spent. I didn't take into account that the precinct that was being built up there, so I had to move that money to cover that cost in the proper place. The fire equipment capital outlay that's gone from 80 to 290, that was a grant that we received to buy air packs. So, fuel has been raised in a couple of different departments just because of the rising cost of fuel.
Understood.
Any other questions? I entertain a motion to approve the amended budget information from Steve.
So moved.
Motion from Vanetta, is there a second?
Second.
Second from Dennis Smoothie. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, motion carries. Next item on the agenda, attorney invoice. You have a copy of that in your packet. This is for the May invoice. The amount's $3,906.25. Entertain a motion to approve this, and we can discuss it if you have any questions. Motion from James Baltimore, is there a second?
Second.
Second from Vanetta. Any questions? Say all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, motion carries. Next item on the agenda, Finance Committee meeting minutes held 10:30 today. Chairman Edward Burks. Edward.
Well, we met right before this meeting at 10:30 today. All committee members were present. We went over the proposed budget, various budget numbers for individual departments. Mayor Holden noted that $6.2 million had been spent on paving over the past 5 years. Mayor Holden made a motion to approve the 22-23 fiscal budget for the motion from, or the second from Alderman Dennis Moody. All committee members voted in favor of the motion, so I would make a motion to adopt the annual budget as presented for the fiscal year beginning July the 1st of 22 and the tax rate of $2.42 per $100 of assessed value, which is the same as last year.
Okay, I have a motion from Edward Burks, a second.
Yeah.
Second from James Baltimore. So let's, bids, there's no bids, right, Greg?
Right.
All right, so let's, with that being said, let's jump down to G for the public hearing for the adoption of our ordinance BB709, which is the budget for 2022-2023 that's contained in your budget book. So we have a motion and a second to approve this. So any discussion about the budget book or any questions about it? Give you some information for some of those that have not been here during some of the Finance Committee meetings. First off, let me thank Sue Teague, Scott Ball, Terrell Holland, Steve Anderson for an exorbitant amount of time that was spent up here in this room going over just about every person in the city. We have 320 full-time and part-time employees. As you all know, back in 1998, the city adopted the current plan that we have now with an 18-year top-out scale. That was done by a wage and hire professional fellow that did that. So this is probably the most significant change, or it is the most significant change, I guess, since then, as far as the pay for our employees and everything. So with that being said, we went through every job classification, 91 total job classifications that the city of Dyersburg has. Discussed about every employee that works for the city full-time and part-time. So we're reducing our top-out time from 18 years to 6 years, okay? So folks with the city of Dyersburg that have been here 6 years will go to top-out, 6 years or more will go to top-out, and those new hires will obviously top-out in 6 years as well. The cost to the city of Dyersburg is in excess of $750,000 for us. We're able to do that because the reduction of our debt overall as a city, thanks to Steve, the proper funding that needed for the retirement plan, and I think the audit showed that it's solvent to 2066. So we're making those contributions as we're supposed to based on all of that stuff that went on. Increase in sales tax. City of Dyersburg has been very fortunate. We're going to bust $15 million in sales tax collections for this budget year, first time ever. And that benefits both the city and county, the city schools, the county schools, and us as well. So it's very important that we continue to grow as a community, to attract industry, to attract business. And it's critical that we have events like softball tournaments and bring people to our town, that we build a soccer complex to bring travel soccer here, that we make improvements at the Fork of Deer River Park, that we make improvements at Kiwanis Park, that folks are involved in Kiwanis Club and Jordan Grab and Go. All y'all are aware of that, but we do that for a reason, and the reason for that is visitors to our community that spend money here. Okay, stay here, spend money here, shop here, support our local folks. So real pleased with the sales tax growth of our community. As I said at a previous meeting, we can't flip a switch July 1 and do this. I wish we could. It is a monumental task that we have undertaken to do this. And we're way far along in this process, but we have some work to do with our payroll systems and all of that that Steve does with Terrell and some other folks, but we will get that done as soon as possible, okay? If you have a specific question about, as far as employees, what your rate of pay will be, we can answer those questions for you. But it's overall, it's a little over 11% increase overall. Some other departments have increased more than that, but the overall impact is close to 12% increase as far as the salaries for the city of Dyersburg employees, okay? So that is significant, and I think it's going to be very beneficial to our employees, both the ones we have now, the ones that have been here for a long time, and the ones that will be new hires for us. Any questions about that? Let me talk about insurance. Some of you have heard this, so our health care coverage for our city employees will not increase this year. This will be the 16th consecutive year that the city of Dyersburg has not had an increase in health insurance, thanks to the employees. To be healthy and do all those things that help us keep our costs low, and thanks to Sue Teague for really jumping in and helping people that need help or whatever it may be. I appreciate Sue very much that she does that. So single insurance is $15 a week, employee and children is $30 a week, employee and spouse is $35 a week, and family coverage is $45 a week. Copay is $25. If it's a specialist, it's $50. And then your prescription cost will be $10, $35, and $50 for generic, preferred, and name brand. $500 deductible for our folks, $1,500 out of pocket, and then $3,000 for the family. So that is a significant benefit for our employees. I hope they appreciate it. I hope they realize how hard we work here, and y'all as well, to keep that at an affordable level for our folks that work for the city of Dyersburg. Part-time folks, their salaries are increasing. Crossing guards, lifeguards, summer help, everybody's getting an increase. Every city employee is getting an increase. Okay, so I'm very thankful for that. Anything else with insurance? We're going to get how much money for health fares? Wellness?
$30,000.
So Sue was able to kind of negotiate that for wellness, health fares, wellness seminars, whatever we can do to get folks in to check their wellness.
Just hoping we can get everybody in on having a health fair and trying to get everyone to think more about the eat and exercise more, so Cigna does provide us some extra money there to do that, so when it comes around, you men come up and get your blood taken. Men don't like needles.
Any questions about the budget, Megan?
So the only folks that are not getting an increase are the mayor and the city judges. Those can't be looked at until October. Is that
the charter states that mayor and alderman and judge, those things have to be done every 4 years in October and prior to an election year. That's what the city charter states.
Okay, so then just in October, review it again.
I think the local government's going to do that, from what I understand. Mary Claire is the chairman of that, and I think that's going to be the process for
us. Thank you.
Any other questions? Public hearing, anybody want to say anything? Certainly welcome to. All right, so we've got a motion and a second to approve the 2022-2023 budget. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, motion carries. Thank you. Next item on the agenda, report from Alderman. Mr. Baltimore?
I'm going to ask, will we have enough people to cover all the pools this year?
I will defer to Andy Baker.
At this point, we do not. I have, yesterday, case in point, we need 12 lifeguards at Okina. We had 9 yesterday. Community center, we were 1 or 2 short there. I have done two and a half classes. I'm certified to teach lifeguard training. Did that because of the shortages we were having. And Ms. Sue, don't we have about 25, 20, 26, 20, probably close to 28 now on the list.
We had 2 added this week.
Right, and even with that, we're probably, since you're bringing that up, probably won't have enough guards, period, to open Okina Pool. That we normally do, even though it's a small crowd on the 4th of July, historically, usually more lifeguards there than swimmers, we're probably not going to have enough guards to open on the 4th.
Wow.
Just because they're, I'll go ahead and use the word, a lot of them seem to have more important things that they think that they need to do, family trips. Yeah, and I understand church trips, school camps, that type of deal right there. But the days of hiring a lifeguard with the understanding that this was their summer job and they were going to have to make some sacrifices, unfortunately, I think. But the work ethic that we have before us now, I think those days are over. And
is it because of rate of pay, or is it just
I'll say this. This is there is a national trend across the country. 1/3 of the pools in the United States are not open this summer, and it's due specifically because of a lifeguard shortage. Beachfronts, Panama City, Orange Beach, all the places we like to go, they're having shortages. You're seeing more swimmers on rest signs. I don't think that we would ever do something. There are some municipalities that are doing swim at your own risk swimming pools, and I think the recipe for disaster. Vanetta's shaking her head. Seriously, the liability that I think that would pose. But we have all 3 pools are up, running, mechanically, chlorinated, ready. I mean, pretty beautiful water in all 3 of them. It's just, we just don't have the staff to do it.
Newman closed their 1 pool, is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct. And we did. We
for some of the same reasons, I mean.
And basically, I was thinking that when that happened, I was like, man.
With gang.
Yeah, I was thinking we're going to get 8, you know, 10, 15 guards from them. What, we have 3?
We have 4 or 5, I think.
Yeah. We have about 2 of those 5 are working on a regular basis. The rest of them fall into that category to where I've had several friends of mine that was just imperative that I get their kids certified, and they've been gone to Florida or somewhere since we trained them more than they've been in Dyersburg. You know, and if it was so imperative to rush them to get them through the class, why have you, and you've been certified for 24 days, why have you only worked 3? You know, that type of deal.
Is there a possibility where you can get them hired the year before?
Well, I'm going to push to do a lot of certifications toward the end of this summer, so when pool season opens next year, we don't have kids that that are expired or expiring soon. They won't expire until after the pool season closes, but that's, it'll take a couple of years to get that cycle. But no, thank you, the board, finance committee, for bumping that up. You know, I was thinking when we went to $10 an hour that it was, eyes would light up, we would have people, you know, knocking each other down to work, and it's just working parties. We have parties or and or water aerobics just about every 3 or 4 nights a week. I'd say we have either water aerobics or parties, and it's like pulling teeth to staff those.
Anything else, Martin? Annette?
No report.
Megan?
No report.
Ricky?
Just, and I say this a lot at the meetings, and I know all of them are not here, but you department heads, I hope y'all know how much y'all appreciate it. I get on phone call, y'all, and y'all are there. That is appreciated. I hope y'all not tell your employees that that's appreciated. Please.
That's it, Mike. Thank you. Edward?
Thanks, Steve, for all your work on the budget. I know it's a time involved and it's a lot to it, so thank you.
Same thing, great budget. I mean, I know we had a lot of questions about it before we got started this year. It's turned out to be real good, so thank you for everybody's hard work.
Thank you, I appreciate it. Again, Sue, Steve, Terrell, Scott, thank y'all for all this. We got a lot of projects going on. We got a bunch. You just don't know. And we are managing those projects and juggling those projects, but in the long run, it's all for the benefit of our community. So, got a lot happening. If you have any questions about any projects, whatever, let us know. We'll certainly fill you in, take you to it, whatever. We had a thing Friday about the multimodal grant that probably people hadn't thought about. We got a multimodal grant, almost $1 million for improvements into South Dyersburg.
That's right. It'd be from Samaritan Road down to the Dodger Store down the Horner Road. That's all that work will be on the west side of the road. It's improved drainage, sidewalks, bike lane, lights. So, and hopefully, once we get this done, when they redo the bridges going out South Main, then we'll tie that last section in, and that way you'll have a safe path from the complex all the way to the Fort Day River Park or to downtown to needed services for people.
How are we getting that funding? What was it?
Some multimodal grant we got from TDOT. $1 million grant with 5% match. Not a whole lot of those were handed out, were they?
No, and we are partnering with TDOT, kind of a pilot project. I think we're going to be the first one out the door, so.
They're going to manage the project, TDOT is.
Yes, and these projects, I mean, we got awarded this well over a year ago, so the grant projects take a while. That's why most grant cycles are 4 years, because it takes 4 years.
So this is 4 years down the road?
No, I'm going to say this is something we get bid out early spring. Yeah, but we've already been a year into it, you know. We're actually meeting on site in 2 weeks, and they'll start the design and the survey, and so hopefully have it out for bid at the end of the year.
How soon before we're hosting some soccer tournaments?
Possibly this fall.
I think we could play this fall, hosting tournaments. I don't know, because you got to get in the clique.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'm not sure how that process goes, but I think we got good grass, good fields, and that's what they look for. There's the Tennessee Soccer Association, several other associations that put on soccer tournaments, kind of like the softball does it at the activity center. So we want to get into those groups of people, have our fields, you know, where we can host. Obviously, we can host as much as anything in West Tennessee.
Who will be the person making the contacts to set that up?
That'd be Andy Baker. No, James, seriously, it'll be a team effort. It'll take a lot. I mean, this is a big complex. It's going to add a lot of work to Parks and Rec. That's almost between 8 and 9 acres of grass out there to be mowed, just in the soccer fields, not even counting everything else in between. But they are paving today. So it's coming along, and it's a learning curve. I mean, we got to figure out what's the most economical way to stripe them, keep them striped and maintain them, and, but we'll get it all figured out, yes.
What about the precinct?
They're finishing sheet rock and painting and about to get all that wound down, so hopefully, you know, this fall should wind up the NDR grant. We've been in it for 6 years now, so. I started about $7.5 million worth of sewer rehab work. Somewhere between $2.5 and $4.5 million of water infrastructure rehab. So there'll be some busy times over the next 3 or 4 years.
Anything else? Thank you all, appreciate it. We're adjourned.